Hello guys, welcome to the FinFET channel. In today's video we are going to try to make a real-time ray tracing game in Python. Just like that. Well, maybe a little less than that, but we will have rays. You probably heard about ray tracing before, but it is not just used for games. If you have already seen any of the Pixar movies, starting from the Cars animation, they all use ray tracing. Not to mention all the cool renderings that you always see around. And what's the catch for ray tracing to generate images that are more faithful to reality? The idea is very simple and very old. To simulate the physical behavior of light and its interactions with objects. But it is kind of backwards, because we are only interested in the light that reaches the camera. And if it is an old idea, why is it only appearing now in games? The point here is real-time ray tracing, which is a requirement for video games, but not for animations. Although ray tracing is relatively simple, it requires a lot of processing, which is why most games use traditional rasterization. Rasterization is a bit more difficult to understand, but requires less processing. Everything is made up of polygons, like triangles, and then the vertices are projected on the screen, and after that the pixels between the vertices are filled according to shading rules, textures, and relative position of other objects. In the case of ray tracing, things are different. You have a camera from which rays are cast for each pixel, and the color of the pixel is determined when the ray hits an object. The basic idea is the same of ray casting. And if you take a look at the games with ray tracing, you will see that they are not all the same. Some games only use ray tracing to make shadows, while others use ray tracing to make shadows and reflections. And there's also global illumination, that has the same logic of reflections with steroids, where the rays keep bouncing until they find the light, with several rays per pixel. To keep things under control, we will deal here only with shadows and reflections. But before we start launching rays, we will have to have a base game, which will be a very simple game, basically the same I showed in previous videos, 3D maze, with a very similar code. I will pass very quickly through all the main components, but if you want, you can also skip straight to the ray tracing part. The main libraries that we will use here are NumPy, matplotlib, and PyInput. And so we start with the base game. First, we will define some parameters and initialize the keyboard listener for the movement. After that, we can generate a random map based on those parameters. The map is created by a random walker and returns the heights, colors, and reflectivity of the blocks, in addition to the exit of the maze. We also need to define the resolution of the game. To make it easier, I use a modifier here because some things depend on the resolution, so it's all changed automatically. And now we start the main game loop. Inside the game loop we have another loop that goes through all the horizontal lines, and one more loop that goes through all the pixels in a row. For each pixel we will cast the rays, but before that we will finish the logic of the game. What is still missing here is to plot the frames, make the player move, and check if he arrived at the exit of the maze. We have two elements in the player's movement, the mouse and the keyboard inputs. The mouse can control the rotation of the player and the camera by bringing the pointer closer to the edges of the screen, with a dead zone on the center, similar to a joystick. To move around with the keyboard, we go back and forth and turn sideways with the arrow keys, and can look up and down using the home and end keys. To interrupt the game, we use the S key. The player can only move if the new position is valid, that is, he cannot cross walls. This is not the Casper maze. Now casting rays. The first ray will be the vision ray. It will leave the player's position and gradually increase until it reaches something, a wall, the ceiling, or the floor. We are going to apply a slightly different texture to the walls, floor, ceiling, and also for the light source, just to make things more interesting. In this way we have the base color of the pixel defined. After that the pixel is darkened based on the distance from the light source. The function returns the color of the pixel, the last position of the ray, and the distance to the light. And with that we have basically the same result as the previous video, with only a slight difference in lighting. Now we can start with the shadows. Shadows are calculated with new rays, which start at the last position of the vision ray and go in the direction of the light.
No! Harry, no! Don't look at the light!
I can't help it! It's so beautiful!
Shading depends on the amount of material that's blocking the light. That way we have soft edges for the shadows, which I find more interesting than flat shadows. The pixels are only shaded when there is something that blocks the ray, otherwise nothing happens and the ray stops when it reaches the ceiling. After the shadows we will deal with the reflections, which only happen when the vision ray encounters a reflective block. Depending on the side of the block that the vision ray impacts, we will invert one of the directions of the ray. After that, we simply call the vision ray again, starting from the last position with a new direction, and then it returns a new color for the pixel, which is averaged with the color of the reflective block. If the new ray finds another reflective block, we will repeat the process, but only once, so as not to have a ray stuck between two mirrors. So, are we done yet? Sort of, but as you can see, even with a very low resolution, the frame rate is just bad. The game is very sluggish. Ray tracing is hard to process. This is the main reason that it's not widely used in games. But we can still try to improve the performance a little. There are three main points that I want to discuss here. First, the algorithm that we are using is very poorly optimized. The ray needs many small increments to cross the empty space on the map. The situation is even worse for higher resolutions that, in addition to having more pixels to calculate, the increments have to be smaller in order to not pass straight through the corners of the blocks. The second point here is Python itself, which is an interpreted language usually not known for its speed. Compiled languages are generally significantly faster. And third, the code here is only using one core of the processor. And this type of application is actually ideal for parallelization. And that's why we use video cards to run games, which are very good for parallel workloads. To optimize the ray, we can take advantage of the grid structure that the map has, using larger increments and only testing when one of the coordinates changes. When we find something, we go back one step to refine the results. With this optimization here, we are able to have a 70% increase in speed. In relation to Python, there are some libraries that can be used to optimize calculations. One of those libraries is Numba, which turns parts of Python code into machine code in real time to speed things up. To use it, we only need to import ngit from Numba and then use a decorator in the functions of the grid ray and shadow ray. We have about 70% additional speed gain. And lastly, we have a more advanced technique using the Python multiprocessing library. In order to use it, we will have to take the parameters of each pixel and put them in a list which will be splitted among the cores. After each core finishes with its part of the list, we combine the results. For this, I created a new function that receives the parameters in each pixel and calls the rays. This is the function that each core will work with. Using 4 cores here, we have a 200% gain in speed. And in total, we have up to 8 times more frames per second. But it remains here around 7 to 8 frames per second for a 56 by 45p resolution, and 2.8 to 3 frames per second for 112 by 90 resolution. It's not that impressive, but it has improved a lot. You can even try to play the game. And with that, we close this video. I will put out the code on GitHub. If you have any questions or suggestions, make sure to write down in the comment section. Thanks for watching, and until the next time.